Hi, I'm Glenn, and we're having a great time here at the Big Geek. Pity you can't be with us right now, but we'll be with you in half an hour at 10 o'clock. Be there or be spanked.
Is the very heart of China. Over here, the Forbidden Palace, from where the emperors ruled the Middle Kingdom. And behind me, the Great Hall of the People, the seat of Communist Party power. And here, Tiananmen Square, for the last 10 days, the focus of world attention. Even now, it's hard to say what is happening in China. The most common answer to my questions in the past week has been, I don't really know. It's not clear yet. China is entering unknown territory as millions discover they can stand up to the Communist Party and demand the basic democratic rights guaranteed in China's own constitution. What they want is a system where everyone is treated the same by law. I've been stopped and told dozens of times about Deng Xiaoping's son and his wealth and how many members of the Politburo have children overseas. It's been a strange revolution for China. Drawing inspiration from the non-violent tactics of India's Mahatma Gandhi and the socialist vision of the Soviet Union's reformer, Mikhail Gorbachev.
The ABC's John Mills reporting from Beijing. Hello and welcome to this ABC News special. I'm Richard Moorcroft. As we go to air this evening, the future of China is in the balance. What began more than a month ago as a simple student protest has developed into a focus for national dissent, as millions show their support for the occupants of Tiananmen Square. That support has surprised the students, stunned China's leaders, and overshadowed a crucial visit by Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev. Our reporter in Beijing, John Mills, explains the escalation of a march by young people into a movement which is certain to change the direction of modern China.
The world's media came to China to cover the historic meeting. President Gorbachev's summit with China's Deng Xiaoping was to end 30 years of poor relations between the communist giants. From the beginning, the visit was a disaster. While the grand masters of communism met, the world's focus was on university students who'd started a sit-in in the historic Tiananmen Square. Soviet and Chinese officials were forced to reschedule most of Mr. Gorbachev's appointments. The media had clearly put the summit to one side. Portable satellite links established for the summit were now being used to beam to the world the most graphic pictures of a new political movement. Oddly enough, Mr. Gorbachev was apparently miffed about the forced postponement or cancellation of his appointments, but the students in the square held him up as a hero. The Western media's enthusiasm for reporting the political protests encouraged the strictly censored state media to break out.
They don't have to, follow the instructions of the Chinese government, and since they are not under that kind of control, their coverage of the student demonstrations could be far more objective and factual and, adequate than the Chinese press.
There was encouragement, too, for the foreign press, which had helped take the student and what was fast becoming a mass public protest to the outside world. Television crews were cheered wherever they went, and it wasn't unusual to be stopped by autograph hunters. While all this was going on, President Gorbachev was fighting a losing battle on the public relations front. Even his trip to the Great Wall was treated as a side story. The real tale was in Tiananmen Square. Storm clouds were brewing over the Chinese Politburo itself, and there was far more to come.
The government might have hoped that last night's extraordinary turnout was a one-off. They were wrong. This afternoon, tens of thousands of people continue to march through the streets of Beijing. There are students, of course, but thousands of ordinary workers, including government officials.
That was one of our last satellite reports. The Chinese authorities had had enough. The Western media had to be stopped.
disconnecting all the cables.
These are the last pictures we'll be showing to you through our own facilities, and if we're able to show any more at all, I know not when. This is Dan Rather, CBS News, Beijing.
The Chinese press, which had flirted with new freedoms and shrugged off their state censorship, was also shut down. It was apparent the Chinese authorities didn't want the world to see what was being planned. Martial law was declared and the army called out. But the government had blundered badly. Around Beijing, tens of thousands of ordinary citizens left their homes to blockade army convoys. There was outrage at the idea of using the People's Liberation Army against Beijing's students. The Chinese say the army and their people should be like fish and water. The soldiers were bewildered and unhappy. Slowly, some were won over. The government, meanwhile, was getting desperate. Tanks and armored vehicles were moved from Mongolia to the edge of Beijing. Helicopter gunships circled low over Tiananmen Square. It was a crude and unsuccessful attempt at intimidation. A pattern quickly developed. Each evening, thousands gathered at major intersections as the blockades went up.
These troops are what we describe as the National Defense Units. And these troops should be used against foreign invaders, not against peaceful people in the country.
The army now says it will not be used to suppress the student protests. The students, officers say, are fellow patriots. Li Peng and his government tried to be tough, but exposed their weakness.
Our reporter, John Mills. For an overview of these pivotal events in China and their consequences, we're crossing to Hong Kong. And waiting to speak to us there is noted China watcher, Professor Wang Gongwu, from the University of Hong Kong. Professor Wang, just how significant in the long term are these protests for China?
I think they're very significant indeed. I think, as reported everywhere, it has been noted that this is the first time the students, with a lot of support from the people, have presented themselves so consistently and strongly against the government.
How is it likely that student leaders or protest leaders can, in any sense, be in control of the protest that has occurred?
I don't think anyone is really in control of anything in particular. I think there are different groups in control of their small group and then doing their utmost to coordinate and to cooperate in trying to keep order in order not to give any excuse for the authorities to crack down on them. So there was at least a determined effort.
I'm good. Last year, the price reforms in China led to panic buying. The panic happened simply because people weren't able to understand what the reasons were for having price reform.
That openness about China's difficulties from the very top has begun to trickle through the political system. For the first time in 40 years of communist rule, newspapers are telling people the bad news about the economy and debating the best solutions. But on China's fast-changing streets, the leaders have one overwhelming fear. What if the radical students demanding democracy were to link up with the discontented ordinary workers hurt by the price rises? It could even sweep the Communist Party from power. Socialism with Chinese characteristics now means China has two utterly contradictory systems, a free market and a communist-planned economy operating side by side. Unbelievably, that results in two prices for the same goods, a low state price, a high free market price. China's nation of shopkeepers took 5 minutes to work out that if you buy low at the state price and sell high, you make a fortune. It's called corruption.
Corruption is so widespread, it's not only limited to a few high-up officials, but it is down to the ordinary rank and file.
China's leaders know that widespread resentment over corruption could destroy the Communist Party unless they restore their moral authority. But the overall leader, Deng Xiaoping, is in his 80s and restricts himself now largely to ceremonial functions. He's barely in control of the great economic forces his reforms have unleashed. The struggle to succeed him may well be between those like General Secretary Zhao Ziyang, who want to speed up the reforms, and conservatives like Premier Li Peng, who want more central control from the party. China's ancient culture somehow survives it all. Even Chairman Mao could not kill traditional operas, though he tried to replace them with musical propaganda. He could not kill the business sense of his people either, and despite the new social strains, it is helping many of them prosper. One import from the West, Marxism, is now apparently less in fashion, and another, consumerism, is in. But the result has been widespread impatience from students, intellectuals, and workers that change is coming too slowly.
Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev's history-making visit to Beijing couldn't have come at a more embarrassing time for the Chinese administration. As the communist superpowers were ending their 30-year rift, the waves of protest overshadowed the momentous reconciliation. Joining me now, ABC Moscow correspondent John Lombard. John, you were with Mr. Gorbachev's entourage in both Beijing and Shanghai. How much of the protest was the Soviet leader able to see or able to be aware of?
Probably very little, because he was isolated from it. He couldn't get through the crowds into Tiananmen Square, had to be brought in a back door. He was in Shanghai, completely isolated from it. They kept him out at a guest house near the airport and never brought him into town at all, where all the main action was.
Apart from detracting from the summit, was there any sense of reaction from him as to his opinion about what was happening?
Not really. He was asked about it during his news conference there, and he said that if it occurred in the Soviet Union, they would try and resolve the situation by discussion and compromise and talk. I'm not sure that that's 100% true, because there's a greater tradition here of using force against demonstrators. But he was certainly not particularly pleased, because, as I say, it did detract from the summit, and it detracted from his appearance there.
How are the Soviet people hearing and seeing the details of the protests in China? How much are they hearing and seeing?
Certainly initially very little indeed. When Mr. Gorbachev was in China, they were seeing only pictures of Mr. Gorbachev and Mrs. Gorbachev attending official functions. And it was slightly ironic, in fact, that while the Chinese students were demonstrating for greater glasnost, greater political freedom, freedom of the press, you could see the real limitations of glasnost here in the Soviet Union, because there was practically no coverage of the student protest. I mean, the newspapers or Radio Moscow, when they do touch on the subject at all, describe the situation in China as complicated. And I think complicated is a euphemism for meaning there's a lot of problems going on there, and they really don't want to know too much about it.
Given that the new friendship between China and the Soviet Union is internationally a very significant event, is there a sense of concern that these developments of protest could affect that new relationship, either strengthen it or weaken it if there's a change of leadership?
Well, I think that's what mostly concerns the people here in the Kremlin, is whether there would be a change of leadership. While the student demonstrations in themselves cause some concern here, because it's certainly not the sort of activity they'd like to see repeated in the Soviet Union, there is perhaps greater concern about which way China is going. And they're keeping a very close eye on what sort of manoeuvrings are going on in Beijing as to whether Deng Xiaoping stays on, or whether Zhao Ziyang makes a return, or Li Peng, or whatever. And I think there is greater concern about what's going to happen and what direction the new leadership will take in China than the student demonstrations in themselves.
John, thank you very much. And so, what of the future for China? Well, all experts seem to agree that the final picture is still very much in the form of an unfinished jigsaw. With so many conflicting influences, it simply isn't possible to predict the outcome. However, with just a few of the pieces in place, the momentum of change looks unstoppable.
The students' chant is, "Chairman Mao is like the sun, which is always bright, but Deng Xiaoping is like the moon. His face changes all the time." The open, brazen denunciation of the Chinese leadership has been one of the many taboos broken in Tiananmen Square, and the leaders presiding over the crisis may soon be finding their positions untenable. Deng Xiaoping, the architect of China's economic recovery, has been in power for over a decade. The Sino-Soviet summit was always viewed as the culmination of the 84-year-old politician's career. But if he decides to step down because of the demonstrations, it won't be as head of state or party chief.
At a time of great unrest, possible breakdown of law and order, control of the armed forces is the major position to hold. Now, if Deng does retire, the most important sign to look for is who succeeds him on this party post in control of the army. That will basically tell you who the new main powerhouse in the Chinese leadership is.
If he goes now, his successor should by rights be one of these men, the five strong standing committee of the Politburo installed by Deng 18 months ago. Zhao Ziyang, the party general secretary, is seen as being on the more liberal wing of the party. He's joined by Hu Qili, an even more outspoken reformer. But to counter them, there are more conservative elements. The prime minister, Li Peng, seen as a lackluster technocrat, and Yao Yilin at 70, the oldest member. The fifth man, seen very much as being in the center, is Chao She, the public security chief. Prime Minister Li Peng's position is currently at most risk, and he's seen as a hardliner by the demonstrators, who also think he got where he is through nepotism, as he was the adopted son of Mao's Prime Minister, Zhou Enlai. The party general secretary, Zhao Ziyang, does on the other hand appear to have kept his liberal credentials during the recent weeks of unrest.
Well, first of all, it's difficult to say what the students want because there isn't a student leader, there isn't a single student voice. The student principals, however, would be the most liberal leader of all, and the most liberal leader who's most likely to succeed is Zhao Ziyang. But the students know only too well that some 2 years ago, the former party boss, Hu Yaobang, was replaced by Zhao Ziyang, and Hu Yaobang is the student's hero as a great liberal. So Zhao has not changed his colors to any great extent.
In his conversation with Mr. Gorbachev 2 days ago, Zhao Ziyang revealed a secret pact made by the party that all major decisions had to be referred to Deng Xiaoping. Many interpreted that as the general secretary pushing blame for the country's problems away from himself. But the course of the protests remains as unpredictable as ever, and no one's ruling out new shifts of power amongst the leadership whose backs are against the wall.
Well, there's little doubt the eyes of the world will be focused on Beijing over the next few weeks. The China story is a continuing and fascinating one. And our final word for this evening comes from our own correspondent in Beijing, John Mills.
We've been pretty optimistic about what's happening in China, but this story's not over yet. There's a lot that could go wrong. If the hardliners in both the government and the military do prevail, then China could be in for another crackdown. Arrests, purges, and the jails full of dissidents. If Deng Xiaoping and Li Peng do cling to power through the use of force, then sooner or later, they'll be reminded of the Chinese saying that you can conquer from horseback, but you must dismount to rule. If Mr. Deng Xiaoping does fall from power, it'll be because he's failed to listen to his people. His extraordinary economic reforms have created a system where a worker can dream of becoming a millionaire, but is denied any say in government. The next rulers of China will have to listen more carefully. The people in Beijing and cities all around China have discovered their voice and found that they like the sound it makes when they work together.
I'm not scared, I will stay here. I'm not scared. I didn't respect the soldiers even before my coming here. Doesn't matter. Somebody got to make some sacrifice.
I'm afraid I don't like to call it a revolution. Perhaps a call for improvement.
The atmosphere is very tense. Students are singing songs, holding hands with each other. There's an air of a pending tragedy, I'm afraid.
Ooh. Hey! You all still here? You the audience for the big gig? It was a good documentary, wasn't it? Hey, come on. Come on, it was very, very interesting. Hey, come on, wake up. Come on, it was very important. Wake up, come on. Everybody, wake up. Come on, stand up, stand up. That's it, everybody up. All right, settle down, settle down. I thought it was a very, very interesting documentary, and it's very, very important. You don't even seem to realize how important it is what's going on in China right now. There are millions of Chinese fighting for their basic democratic rights. Freedom of speech!
Yes!
Decent programming!
Yes!
The right to form a proper opposition party!
Yes!
So come on! Let's show some solidarity for our friends in China. Let's show some solidarity for people everywhere who know what it's like to be pushed around and kicked about. Chong Kama! Chong Xiao Lei!
Xiao Lei!
Yashi Chong!